Hare Krishna and welcome all devotees. So we have read the purport of the second shloka till here. So we have last couple of paragraphs left from the second shloka of the first chapter of the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. So we'll continue. Anybody would like to read? Volunteer for reading? The highlighted part.
I can read, Hare Krishna.
Yes, go ahead.
Go ahead, Mataji.
Please. Nahi padho beta, aap padho.
Over and above this, Srimad Bhagavatam is a personal commentation on the Vedanta Sutra by Sri Vyasadeva. It was written in the maturity of his spiritual life through the mercy of Narad. Sri Vyasadeva is the authorized incarnation of Narayana, the personality of Godhead. Therefore, there is no question as to his authority. He is the author of all other Vedic literatures, yet he recommends the study of Srimad Bhagavatam above all others. In other Puranas, there are different methods set forth by which one can worship the demigods. But in the Bhagavatam, only the Supreme Lord is mentioned. The Supreme Lord is the total body, and the demigods are the different parts of that body. Consequently, by worshipping the Supreme Lord, one does not need to worship the demigods. The Supreme Lord becomes fixed in the heart of the devotee immediately. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has recommended the Srimad Bhagavatam as a spotless Purana and distinguishes it from all the other Puranas. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you, Mataji, for reading. I think we'll continue to read. Anything anybody would like to add here? I think we have discussed most of these points, and they're very beautifully and nicely written by Srila Prabhupada in an easily understandable manner. So we'll continue to read. Who would like to read the next? Nilamati, you were going to read.
Yes. The proper method for receiving this transcendental message is to hear it submissively. A challenging attitude cannot help one realize the transcendental message. One particular word is used herein for proper guidance. This word is Sushruta. One must be Sushruchu. One must be anxious to hear this transcendental message. The desire is to sincerely hear is the first qualification. Less fortunate persons are not at all interested in hearing this Srimad Bhagavatam. The process is simple, but the application is difficult. Unfortunate people find enough time to hear idle social and political conversations, but when invited to attend a meeting of devotees to hear Srimad Bhagavatam, they suddenly become reluctant. Sometimes, professional readers of the Bhagavatam immediately plunge into the confidential topics of the pastimes of the Supreme Lord, which they seemingly interpret as sex literature. Srimad Bhagavatam is meant to be heard from the beginning. Those who are fit to assimilate this work are mentioned in this shloka. One becomes qualified to hear Srimad Bhagavatam after many pious deeds. The intelligent person who, with thoughtful discretion, can be assured by the great sage Vyasadeva that he can realize the Supreme Personality directly by hearing Srimad Bhagavatam. Without undergoing the different stages of realization set forth in the Vedas, one can be lifted immediately to the position of Paramhans, simply by agreeing to receive this message. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. So as we have discussed before, Hamsa means one who is a kind of an animal bird which seeks the essence. So if you mix water and milk and give it to the Hamsa will take out the milk, drink the milk, leave behind the water. So that is Hamsa. So Paramhamsa means topmost. in that. Topmost means who is looking for the essence. And that is the great personalities, the great devotees are. And Prabhupada is mentioning that anybody can actually get to that platform, Paramsa, if one wants to directly go there without undergoing different stages of the Vedas, then one should simply hear this Srimad Bhagavatam and practically apply in his life and share with others. One can immediately see how this will be so practical and easy to apply as compared to so many of the other things which are given in the Vedas. So somebody may say, oh, is it easy? Well, sometimes the easy word can be very relative, right? If you want, let's say, a house and you're getting it maybe one third of the cost, market is down and you're getting it one third of the cost, it may still cost you, you know, $250,000 or $300,000. But somebody may say, oh my God, that's a steal. That's like dirt cheap. So basically that's too much money, but still relative terms, it's very cheap. So similarly, the process which is given to us, actually, if you compare to all the different processes in the Vedic scriptures, there are so many processes which are mentioned. And this process of Krishna consciousness actually is the such an easy way that many of you may have heard pennies for the dollar, right? You can buy something, pennies for the dollar means it may cost, you know, a dollar and you are getting it for like 5 cents or 10 cents. So much cheaper. So similarly here, you are getting a very good deal. That's why people like Black Friday, right? Because you get so many good deals. So here Srimad Bhagavatam is like Black Friday. And when we understand it in the disciplic succession coming through Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Nityananda Prabhu and their followers, then it is even more accessible to go to the highest realm. जैसे हिंदी में कहते हैं ना, सोने पे सुहागा हो गया, तो वही है ये, सोने पे सुहागा हो गया कि भाई first of all Srimad Bhagavatam is great and then Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came, he made it even more accessible. So Prabhupada has taken this teachings of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and given it as an English language. So we are very fortunate actually that we are born and brought up in a time period where we have access to this knowledge anywhere, wherever we may be. Okay, anybody else would like to share any thoughts? We have completed the second shloka of Srimad Bhagavatam. We are going to go to the third shloka next. So if anybody wants to share some thoughts, they can share now before we go forward. Okay.
Hare Krishna, yes. Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Prabhuji, मुझे second last line में थोड़ा एक confusion आया है. Where Prabhupada is saying one becomes qualified to hear Srimad Bhagavatam after many pious deeds. So Prabhuji, yes. ऐसे बोलते हैं कि even एक बार भगवान का नाम उच्चारण करने से ही सारे पापों से तर जाते हैं, या I mean बैकुंठ के भी अधिकारी बन सकते हैं, but इसके लिए श्रीमद भागवतम को पढ़ने के लिए I mean why we need like all pious deeds? This part is little bit confusing, Prabhuji.
No, this plant is can be confusing. This is a good question. But the point here is, if you have come to the platform that you are getting a chance to hear Srimad Bhagavatam, that in itself means that in your previous life, you have already done so many pious works, so many things you have done, that Krishna has got pleased and giving you the association of devotees who can give you the Srimad Bhagavatam. So don't make a mistake of taking it cheaply this life. Some people think, oh, you know, what is this? not a big deal. I can go and buy from somewhere, or so many Hare Krishna, they are going here and there, I can get. But actually, no, you did so much hard work. Now you have cracked your competitive exam. Let's say somebody wants preparing for IIT. So he's already gone admission into the IIT. Now, so they are told that you have already worked so hard. Now you have to study in IIT. Not like just, you know, take it easily and then fail the exam. Does it make sense? So you have already done so many pious activities and everything that you are getting a chance now to take admission into this Srimad Bhagavatam Academy of International Society of Krishna Consciousness, where Prabhupada has given it for everybody. So you have done so many things in the past because of which Krishna is very pleased from you. So especially Krishna is giving you this chance. Now, that doesn't mean that we are spiritually very advanced. Getting into entrance into a medical college doesn't mean you are a, you know, super specialist neurosurgeon. It means you have that opportunity if you stay in the medical college and get proper training. So similarly, but it doesn't mean that you have not done any hard work. You've done a lot of hard work before, and now you've got a chance to enter into medical college. So similarly here, you have done a lot of things in the past. And now by the mercy of the Lord and the devotees, you're getting this chance to get into the deeper sections of the Vedic scriptures, which is the highest one is Srimad Bhagavatam. Does it answer your question, Madhuji?
Yes, Prabhuji, it's making sense now. Thank you, Prabhuji.
Thank you. Anybody else would like to share any thoughts on Mataji's question?
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Yes,
Prabhuji. Prabhuji, I might be wrong. I was listening one lecture of the Amogh Leela Prabhu. That the here it's the conflicting with that statement. So I'm not sure how to relate it. So then Prabhuji was saying that we think that we did the very good deed, or the pious karma, or the good karma, or the pious activities, so many auspiciousness. But all this does not matter until and unless we'll get the mercy of Krishna. It's not possible.
Yes, Prabhuji.
Yeah.
You're right. So just like we say that you've done a lot of hard work to come to the competitive exam and cleared it, but still you need mercy of Krishna and luck, because so many people work so hard. Everyone does not get through the competitive exam, right? There are like 10 lakh people appearing, and there are, you know, at the max 1,000 or 2,000 seats. So everybody doesn't get admission. Luck factor, mercy factor plays a role. So you may have done a lot of things, but then you get a mercy of Krishna, then only you go forward. That's why I was saying that you have got the mercy. So the point here is you should not be puffed up. अरे अब तो मैंने बहुत मैंने पिछले जन्म में बहुत अच्छे काम किए होंगे तभी मैं आया हूँ. No, not like that. It's not your credit.
Only the
absolute. Don't have to be puffed up about that. It is Krishna's mercy ultimately. Whatever you did is just, you know, your part. You may have done some little thing, but the point is at the same time you should not take it cheaply. That anybody, so many people don't get access to Srimad Bhagavatam, right? So they have to go through some or the other more purification. If we are getting a chance, we should feel very grateful that, oh, just like a person who gets admission to medical college, he gets, or engineering college, he'll be very, you know, careful that, okay, somehow I have, you know, come to this level. Now I have to take it very seriously. Not easy to get this chance. Otherwise, people take it cheaply. Does it make sense?
Yeah, sounds good, probably. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anybody wants to add anything to that?
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Yes,
Prabhuji, I just remembered an analogy I've heard in this regard in one of the lectures. I think Amrinder Prabhu's lecture. So he was sharing that, let's say it's there's a little kid who's calling out to his father. And he wants to be lifted up into the arms of his father. So he does many nice things. He may card for him, give him a flower, pull on his shirt, cry. So he will do many things. But then ultimately, the father will, whether father bends down to lift the child up is up to the father still. So sometimes a child may not make much effort and father will still lift him up in his arms. Sometimes the child is crying for a long time, pulling on his shirt a lot, raising up his arms, please lift me up, father, and then the father will bend down. But ultimately, it's just the causeless mercy of the father that he decides to bend down and lift up the child. So I just realized that analogy fits here.
Thank you, Mataji. Thank you for sharing. All right. So we'll go, move forward. Anybody else wants to share anything?
Yeah, I just want to ask a dumb question. Now, sometimes if I don't really understand everything, but I don't remember everything like everybody else does, I mean, still, do I get the same benefits? Because, you know, this is what it is.
So, yes, Mataji, this is a very good question. Mataji, honestly speaking, I am probably least attentive than anybody else. All the devotees, you know, they seem to share, remember so many things. I have to hear so many times, then I will remember something. But the point is that if we are able to remember or not remember, that is not as important as our eagerness to hear and sincerity to hear. If we are eager and sincere to hear and not want to miss a word, then we will get a lot of benefit. Even if we are not able to remember, even if we may not have the intelligence to understand, even if we don't have a capability to really comprehend and learn all the shlokas. But if we are eager, interested, attentive, have that attitude, submissive attitude, which Prabhupada had also mentioned here, then definitely we will have lots and lots of benefit. We can't even imagine how much. There are so many examples. There's an example of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu meeting South India Brahman, who was just trying to recite the shlokas of Bhagavad Gita, and he was not even very learned. He was not a very advanced Brahman. He was just, you know, trying to follow the orders of his guru. And just by that attitude, serious and sincere attitude, even though he was not able to really recite properly or understand properly, he was able to please the Lord much more than other people who knew the whole scripture and reciting. So that is one point to remember. Now, the other point to remember is there is a story of, I don't remember the exact thing, but many of you may remember, Nitai Semni Mataji and other devotees mentioned this story of, what is the name? Dundukari? Dundukari and what is the other one?
Oh yeah, the bell, the badat.
Gokarna
and Dundukari, correct.
Yeah,
so, Siddha Mataji, you want to tell that story?
Yeah, actually, I know that.
You know, okay, Mataji.
I mean, if you other people want to hear, that's fine.
Yeah, Siddha Mataji, maybe you can share because many devotees may not know.
Okay, just maybe I can try. So there was a Brahmin and he got married to a woman whose name was Dunduli. Yes. So, and she was very much into this material things, and you know, she was not at all a devotee, but that Brahmin was a very pure devotee. And they were trying for a child, but they didn't have a child for a very long time. So then he thought that he will go, you know, and to plan to go to some rishi and said that, you know, I'll work and, you know, I just want a child. So then the rishi, Prabhuji, I don't know. I mean, I know the story, but maybe, you know, I'm forgetting some words. So then rishi said, okay, you know, I give you one fruit and you give this fruit to your wife, and then when she will eat, she will have a child. So he goes back, give that fruit to his wife, and the wife said, no, I don't want to eat because
you know, she was not interested for a child or something like that. But then at the same time, her sister was actually pregnant that time. And then she gave that, so she asked her sister that, you know, I don't want to have a child. And, you know, my husband is forcing me that we should have a child. Then she said, okay, you pretend to be a pregnant, you know, lady for some months. And then when I will deliver the baby, I will give the baby to you. So she agrees to that. And then she throws that fruit, which given by the sage, she throws it. And then one cow, she actually, the cow eats that fruit. So once and she keeps pretending to be, pregnant for some months. And when her sister delivers the baby, she gives that baby to Dhunduli. And then she shows it, that now we have a boy. And then the Brahmin was very, very happy. But after some time, when the kid was growing, he was not at all, into God service or not a devotee, then he was doing all the impious stuff like killing people and, he has that demoniac character. So that cow actually also delivered a baby after eating that fruit. So that calf has a half man and half animal body, and he has this. So his name, that calf name was Gokarn, and that Dhundukari actually was doing a lot of impious stuff, and then he was, involved with some prostitutes as well. And then someday it happened that he was not able to do, he wanted money or something, and then he did something, he killed someone, and then those prostitutes thought that, we are also involved in this, so if some, the king gets to know, then we will also be punished. So they actually end up killing the Dhundukari. So they named the guy Dhundulis, and that Brahmin's son Dhundukari. And then Dhundukari actually, so when they killed the Dhundukari, so that Dhundukari actually, because of his,
so everybody should pay attendance here, attention here, okay. Onwards, this is the most important part of the whole story. Yes, Mataji, go ahead. This is the most important part.
So the Gokarna actually got to know that Dhundukari was my brother, and then because of his impious deeds, he was not able, he's still, I don't know what to say, Prabhuji, kehte hai na, wo atma beech mein hi latak jati hai, and he was, he became a ghost, yeah. So then Gokarna said that, I will recite the Srimad Bhagavatam part for him, and then he kept the 7 days apart for his brother Dhundukari, and then Dhundukari was tied up in a tree with 7 knots. And then every day when he was reading one chapter, that his one knot was opened. So that's how in 7 days, when they finished the whole, in the Bhagavatam, and then he was free and he reached Vaikuntha, Krishna's abode. So it is said in this that this is actually the importance of Srimad Bhagavatam, as we've seen, in Parikshit Maharaj's life also, that if you hear the Bhagavatam, even the dead people or the ghost also get relieved. So that's how Gokarna actually helped his brother to reach God's Dham. Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Please forgive me for mistakes, because I heard it long time back.
So basically, the long story here is short is, everybody started asking, he heard it for 7 days and he got perfection. What about us? We also heard it 7 days, because many other people were there also. And we don't see that we have had that much change. And at that time, the answer was provided that actually it is not just hearing. It is how eagerly, sincerely, attentively you are wanting to hear. What is your desire? Some people, they may go to satsang or something, and they are thinking, "Arey, kya, what is the prasadam? What is the prasadam going to be? Is it going to be like some paneer sabji will be there or not? Or maybe, having gulab jamuns or no gulab jamun?" But here Parikshit Maharaj and Sukhdev Goswami, when they were reciting Srimad Bhagavatam, do you know what prasadam they had? Very simple prasadam, right? Anybody can remember what prasadam items they had? Water. They had no prasadam, no water, nothing. For 7 days, 7 nights, continuously they were hearing, and they didn't even realize. It wasn't like they were thinking that when will this get over, you know? It's going on. No, they were in rapt attention. And Parikshit Maharaj, of course, he was about to die. He's listening. But the other sages, isn't like the other sages are finding some tree. Okay, yahan pe hum chadar bicha lete hain apni sone ke liye, raat mein rest lete hain. You know, we'll rest. The Parikshit ko to apna usko sunna hai. He's going to die. You know, let him think. At least we can take rest. It wasn't like that. Each of them were hearing it, pin drop silence. If there is a pin drop, then it will be a big disturbance. That is how the atmosphere was. Everybody was rapt attention. Now, if we have that attitude, if we have that seriousness, that sincerity, then definitely we are going to get benefit. No matter what is, it does not depend on our intelligence level. It does not depend on our reading level, intellectual level, understanding level. No. That is why it is called as a causeless mercy. It is not on any material cause. It is not dependent on material cause. But Krishna is attracted by our qualities. Krishna is attracted by how eagerly, seriously, sincerely, humbly we are submitting ourselves at the feet of the devotees and the Vaishnavas, asking questions, hearing, attentively thinking, using our intelligence in understanding, questioning. Questioning is a sign of intelligence. To doubt is a sign of intelligence. So if we are submissively using doubt and intelligence in clarifying the concepts, that is very good. And if we are eagerly, seriously, sincerely wanting to hear and engage in that, then we get the benefit. In fact, we'll read the shlokas going forward and the sages will be really say very appreciative of those who are asking questions. Because somebody here was saying, I'm asking dumb questions, silly questions. Somebody was saying, I think. But actually, when they are asking questions, the response they are getting from the great sages is that, oh, wow, your questions are perfect. Because questions like these actually benefit the one who asks the question, the one who answers the question, and everyone else who is there in audience or who will listen to it in future. So each one of them will get benefit, and they are the source for complete satisfaction of mankind by knowing these, by asking spiritual questions like these. So questions are always welcome.
Thank you.
That is the answer.
Oh, okay. Actually, we still have the tradition, you know, like after my father and mother passed away, you know, we sibling did, you know, Bhagavatam for 7 days, you know, with that, the lakdi, you know, the bamboo bolte, usko, you know, we had the whole ritual we had.
Yes, Mati. Mati, did your question get answered?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So we'll move forward. So we'll go to the third shloka. Now this one, anybody knows this shloka before? Anybody has recited, would like to recite?
This is a little bit easier than the previous one.
Maybe a little bit easier, but this is, I don't have a way of singing it. So I'm not very, you know, very good at reciting this one, but I can try. And if anybody else would like to do, Anand Kishori, you want to try this one? Otherwise, I can pray. Okay, this is simple. Simply, I'll just recite and everybody else can repeat. Nigam kalpataror galitam phalam.
पिबत
भागवत रसम आलयम् मुहुरहोरसिका भुवि भावुका Okay, any would you want to try to read the translation?
I can read, Prabhuji. Yes, Prabhuji, go. Translation. O expert and thoughtful men, relish Srimad Bhagavatam, the mature fruit of the desire tree of Vedic literatures. It's emanated from the lips of Sri Sukadeva Goswami. Therefore, this fruit has become even more tasteful. Although its nectarian juice was already relishable for all, including liberated souls. Haribu.
Hare Krishna. So now I'm going to just summarize a little that what is going on. Srimad Bhagavatam, the teachings of Srimad Bhagavatam actually is eternal. It is not that only when this book is actually written, that is when the teachings are given. No, these are eternal teachings. Just like Lord Shri Krishna gave Bhagavad Gita to Arjun 5,000 years ago. That doesn't mean Bhagavad Gita is 5,000 years old. Bhagavad Gita is eternal. Therefore, Krishna had given the science to many, many people at different times. Krishna says in the fourth chapter that he gave this knowledge to whom? In the past. The knowledge of
Manu?
Yes. Yes. So, he gave to the sun god. So, from sun god, it was going on. So like that was long time back. So similarly, this knowledge is eternal. So Ved Vyas gave the knowledge to his son Sukadev Goswami, and Sukadev Goswami was the one who spoke to Parikshit Maharaj. Now Parikshit Maharaj heard it, but along with that, lots of other saints, sages and rishis heard it there. And one of the people who heard it over there was, other than Parikshit Maharaj,
I think Partha Kishore, the other place, the Shankar told the same thing to Parvati.
Yes, very nice. So Lord Shiva also told the knowledge of Srimad Bhagavatam to Mother Partha. Yes. Who else is there? Was there in the audience?
This is Sudh Goswami,
yes. Goswami is the one whom we are talking about, who was there in the audience with Parikshit Maharaj. And then Sudh Goswami, so I think Sudh Goswami, he learned the whole teaching which was given to Parikshit Maharaj, and everything was in the memory of Sudh Goswami. So these people are called as Shrutidhar. Previously, people used to be Shrutidhar, many of them. They will hear one thing and they will never forget. Now, of course, we have pen, paper, pencil. We can't even remember phone numbers. But previously, it wasn't like that. You tell something, you have to remember. I have no other option. And people's memory was very, very sharp. So Sudh Goswami knew the whole Bhagavatam. So as he was walking down, he came to Naimisharanya, and there were lots of rishis in Naimisharanya, and they were doing sacrifice, yagya. They were doing it for 1,000 years. And because of the yagya, so much soot had come, their whole bodies were covered black. And when they saw Sud Goswami, they actually did all of this yagya for the satisfaction and benefit of mankind. And then when they saw Sud Goswami, they inquired from him. They inquired various questions. Now, Ved Vyas, who is writing the Bhagavatam, he is writing that conversation between the Sud Goswami and the sages of Naimisharanya. He's starting from there. Okay? So as we go forward, things will become more clear. Am I right? Anybody would like to ask any question or make any comments or correct me if I said anything wrong? Okay. So here in the third shloka, it is being mentioned how this Srimad Bhagavatam is very, very important because it is the mature fruit. Galitam, gala. Hum kehte hai na sabji mein gal gayi hai ki nahi gali. If some fruit, if we want to eat, we ask whether it is, you know, raw or is it ripe. So ripe means galava, galitam. So is it ripe? Yes, this Srimad Bhagavatam is actually the ripe fruit, mature fruit. Fruit of where? Of the tree. Which tree? The Vedas. Vedas are like the tree. And the Srimad Bhagavatam is the fruit. And even in the fruits, there could be many fruits. But it seems like when a parrot eats a fruit, then the fruit even becomes more tasty. Or maybe parrot tastes the fruit which is actually most tasty. Either way. So similarly, because parrot has tasted the fruit, that is very tasty. Similarly, because Sukhdev Goswami, who is an advanced devotee, a Vaishnava, from his mouth, Bhagavatam is coming out. Even though it was anyways very, very nectarian, now it has become even more tasteful. So now this is very good. So in the beginning only, Ved Vyas is making statements here so that we are clear about what book we are going to read now. It's not some, you know, hocus pocus here and there book, which is going to be of no use. No. He, from first shloka, he gave the definition of the absolute truth. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, and started talking about who is the absolute truth? How even the great demigods can get bewildered? How, like, people see mirage, water in fire, or land in ocean, and you know, demigods are bewildered. There are so many things he mentioned in the first shloka. And then in the second shloka, how he said that this book is going to reject all the nonsense, lower level of dharma. No, the highest. And here, he's telling this is actually the ripe fruit, the best thing in all the Vedic scriptures. Very, very tasty. So, like that, he is preparing the readers that what you are going to read is something which you will never find anywhere else. Whatever is there anywhere else, you'll find in this work. But what is here, you may not necessarily find in other places because it's so, so very rich. I will read the purport now. Who would like to read?
I can read.
Yes, Nirmala Mataji, you can read the first paragraph.
Purport. In two previous lokas, it has been definitely proved that Srimad Bhagavatam is sublime literature which surpasses all other Vedic scripture due to transcendental qualities. It is transcendental to all mundane activities and mundane knowledge. In this shloka, it is stated that Srimad Bhagavatam is not only superior literature, but it is ripened fruit of all Vedic literature. In other words, it is the cream of all Vedic knowledge. Considering all this patient and submissive hearing, is definitely essential with great respect and attention. One should receive the message and lessons imparted by the Srimad Bhagavatam.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. So patient and submissive hearing is essential. Okay. Who will read the second paragraph?
I can read Guruji.
Yes, sir. Rachel.
The Vedas are compared to the desired tree because they contains all things knowable by man. They deal with mundane necessities as well as spiritual realization. The Vedas contains regulative principle of knowledge covering social, political, religious, economic, military, medicinal, chemical, physical, and metaphysical subject matter and all that may be necessary to keep the body and soul together. Above and beyond all, these are specific direction for spiritual realization. Regulative knowledge involves a gradual raising of living entity to the spiritual platform, and the highest spiritual realization is knowledge that the personality of Godhead is reservoirs of all spiritual tests and rasas.
So the highest spiritual realization is the knowledge that personality of Godhead is reservoir of all spiritual tastes and rasas. See, this is the thing which differentiates Mayavad philosophy from Vaishnava philosophy. In Vaishnava philosophy, we are very much focused about how Supreme Lord is someone with whom there could be exchanges of emotions, the rasas, the spiritual rasas. And that is very, very key to be actually getting bliss. Because until and unless we don't have those exchanges with the Lord, we will actually not feel the ananda. And Mayavadis do not have similar understanding. So if somebody is following Mayavadi's perspective, they are not very much focused in giving Krishna the loving service, because that is not the priority for them. They may focus on detachment, they may focus on living a life of austerity, but they forget about attachment to Krishna. And in that, when we serve Krishna and understand the Supreme Personality of God is the reservoir of all spiritual rasas, then we can actually have the loving reciprocation with him. Does it make sense?
Yes.
You're reading? Who will read next?
I can read.
Yes, please. You are mute.
Sorry. Every living entity, beginning from Brahma, the first born living being within the material world, down to the insignificant ant, desires to relish some sort of taste derived from sense perceptions. These sensual pleasures are technically called rasas. Such rasas are of different varieties. In the revealed scriptures, the following 12 varieties of rasas are enumerated. One, first is Rodra, anger. Second, Adbhut, wonder. Third is Shringar, conjugal love. Fourth is Hasya, comedy. Fifth is Vatra, Veer Ras. Chivalry. Six is Daya, mercy. Seventh, Dasya, servitorship. Eighth is Sakya, fraternity. And ninth is Bhayankar, horror. Tenth is Vibhasa, shock. 11th is Santa, neutrally. And Vatsalya. 12th, last is Vatsalya, parenthood.
Hare Krishna. Shanta. 11th is Shanta.
Correct. Hari. Okay. So why is these rasas important? Because we are all longing for such a rasa. Everyone desires to relish some sort of a taste. That is why we engage in whatever activity we engage. We are looking for that rasa. The satisfaction actually comes from these tastes. And that's why everybody is on social media. Why? Because they are looking for establishing the relationship because that has a rasa. Before also we have discussed, without any relationship, we cannot actually get satisfaction. So therefore, highest relationship is relationship with Krishna. And if that relationship is not there and one has no other relationship, then he wants to have a relationship by social media or by making friends or by keeping pets, some or the other means one needs to have those relationships. And if we are focusing on our relationship with Krishna, which can actually be the highest, then Prabhupada is mentioning that there are 12 varieties of relationship rasas. So sometimes people may say, oh, you know, we heard only 5. What are these 12? So actually the 5 are the primary rasas and then remaining are the secondary rasas. Secondary rasas are happening along with the primary rasas. So that is a separate topic. So we'll continue a bit for now reading and then we'll discuss this sometime later. Okay, who would like to read next?
Can I read, Prabhuji? Hare Krishna.
Yes, Mataji. Okay,
the sum total of all these rasas is called affection or love. Primarily, such signs of love are manifested in adoration, service, friendship, parental affection, and conjugal love. And when these 5 are absent, love is present indirectly in anger, wonder, comedy, chivalry, fear, shock, and so on. For example, when a man is in love with a woman, the rasa is called conjugal love. But when such love affairs are disturbed, there may be one anger, shock, or even horror. Sometimes love affairs between 2 persons culminate in ghastly murder scenes. Such rasas are displayed between man and man and between animal and animal. There is no possibility of any exchange or rasa between a man and an animal or between a man and any other species of living entity within the material world. The rasas are exchanged between members of the same species. But as far as the spirit souls are concerned, they are one qualitatively with the Supreme Lord. Therefore, the rasas were originally exchanged between the spiritual being and the spiritual whole, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The spiritual exchange or rasa is fully exhibited in spiritual existence between living beings and the Supreme Lord. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you, Mataji. So rasa is a, you know, is a big topic. And why is Prabhupada taking it? Because here it is mentioned in this very shloka, like I was mentioning, the first shloka talks about sambandha, establishing our relationship. Second shloka, abhidhe. And third, prayojan. So prayojan means the highest platform where the devotees are actually experiencing the relationship with the Supreme Lord, which is actually the rasas. So this is a deep subject matter. So we'll, you know, discuss more when we go forward. So right now, let's keep reading. Okay. Any volunteers who would like to read next?
I can read, Prabhuji.
Yes, Prabhuji. I think we have to read from here, right?
Yes,
Prabhuji.
No. In the shloka, right?
Yes, in the shloka.
Yeah. In this shloka, it is definitely stated that spiritual rasa, which is relished even in the liberated stage,
can be experienced. So do we have to, I think I'm just making sure that I'm I think we have to read here. Sorry. Very sorry. Because this one we just read about the rasas. This one.
Rasas were originally exchanged between spiritual living being and the spiritual whole. Yes. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is therefore described in this, in the Shruti Mantras, Vedic hymns, as the fountainhead of all rasas. When one associates with Supreme Lord and exchanges one's constitutional rasa with the Lord, then the living being is actually happy. These Shruti Mantras indicate that every living being has its constitutional position, which is endowed with a particular type of rasa to be exchanged with the personality of Godhead. In the liberated condition only, this primary rasa is experienced in full. In the material existence, the rasa is experienced in the perverted form, which is temporary, and thus the rasas of the material world are exhibited in the material form of raudra, anger, and so on. Should I keep reading, Prabhuji? Therefore,
so, unless you want to explain something, you can explain.
I think we'll read this one more also, Prabhuji. Therefore, one who attains full knowledge of these different rasas, which are the basic principle of activities, can understand the false representation of the original rasas, which are reflected in the material world. The learned scholar seeks to relish the real rasa in the spiritual form. In the beginning, he desires to become one with the Supreme. Thus, less intelligent transcendentalist cannot go beyond this conception of becoming one with the spirit whole without knowing of the different rasas. Hare Krishna. So yes, Prabhu, here it is described that there are different rasas in which we talked about that we can have different exchanges with the Lord. And once we are at a spiritual platform, then we can realize what is our original position and what rasa we can exchange with the Lord. And and once we are doing that, then when we are exchanging that kind of rasa or exchanges with the Lord, then we can be actually happy. While in this material world, we are just trying to have this perverted form of the rasas with the other living beings, and that leads to anger, frustration, and other problems, because that is not how it is supposed to be. That is not the constitutional form these rasas are supposed to get exchanged. So that's what I understand, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you, Prabhuji. Anybody else would like to share anything? Otherwise, we'll read one more paragraph. Yes, Ankita.
Prabhuji, एक छोटा सा क्वेश्चन है इसमें जो 12 रसास डिस्कस किए हैं यहाँ पर उससे पहले पैराग्राफ में प्रभुजी जैसे कोई बहुत सारे लोग हैं जो भगवान को ऐसे अपना सुप्रीम फादर या परम पिता समझते हैं या उनसे प्रोटेक्शन ऐसे फीलिंग रहता है वो प्रभुजी वो कौन से रसा में रहेगा वात्सल्य रस में या
माता जी दिस इज इन द प्योर लेवल द रसास What you are talking is not is people who are who are not yet in that level of consciousness.
So, like Prabhuji, like Dhruva Maharaj, like he, I mean, I'm not sure if I'm giving the correct example, but I was just thinking if so.
So like as I said, when you have a loved one, do you like to give love to that person or receive love from that person? If you have a child, you want to love the child or you want to receive?
I guess Prabhuji, both ways.
Actually, in giving, we receive.
Okay.
So when we give, that is when we actually receive. Till the time we are not giving and till the time we are wanting, then we are unfulfilled. Our we are unsatisfied, we remain dissatisfied because we are wanting. Actually, the real identity for us is for humans or souls is to serve, to give to others. So in giving we receive. So basically the Supreme Lord, our relationship with the Lord is actually in one of these five rasas. And when we are not at that level of purity, at that time we have to go through different stages. So somebody will say, Lord is my protector, or Lord is the Supreme Father, and all those things are true, but they are preliminary. They are not the purified level where we have understood our relationship with the Lord. Like, for example, if somebody is in Shantaras, like the great examples of great devotees, they meditate on the Supreme Lord, may consider them as the Supreme Controller, and they offer prayers to them. So that is more in the Shantaras. Those in the Dasyaras, they want to offer service to the Lord. So in these two category, most people will come who are, let's say, worshipping Narayan, or who's worshipping Lord as a Supreme Controller, proprietor. Does it make sense? Even I'm talking about even those who have attained perfection. But most people who have not attained perfection, they don't come in actually any of these categories because they have not realized. This is like Swarupa Siddhi, right? So we have not achieved Swarupa Siddhi, like Prabhupada has given a hint in earlier. He said, when one actually advances, then he realizes his perfect relationship with the Lord. Right now, we don't realize. It's not that we have to choose one of these, that, oh, maybe I will love Krishna in this way. It's not like that. We don't have to choose. We have to serve him as a humble servant only. We have to serve him as the servant of the servant of the servant. And then Krishna will give us realization by which we'll be able to understand what is our real constitutional position with the Lord. So there's a lot of difference on we assuming, we thinking, we wanting, but this is not based upon what our mind is asking you to act like. Does it clarify, Mataji?
Yes, Prabhuji. Thank you, Prabhuji.
Thank you, Mataji. Anybody else would like to add anything to Mataji's question to answer it? Anybody who has any further questions on this? Is it making sense what we are discussing?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Yes, Prabhuji.
Okay, so I think because of time constraints, we are coming towards the end of today's session. So should we end it here? It's 9:05.
Prabhuji, when do we have Ekadashi, today or tomorrow?
Tomorrow. We have Ekadashi tomorrow.
Prabhuji,
impression that it's today, but all
Prabhuji, I kept it today actually.
Oh, okay.
Whole day. And actually, Nivan in the calendar wrote 22nd, so I thought it's today. So I kept Ekadashi first.
Actually, I also initially prepared for today, but then I heard that it's not today. I think in the conference call, only one of the devotees had mentioned sometime back. So then I